know your name. A better yet, stay limp, just do that. I wanna know your name. You just killed me, could you please do that? I wanna know your name. A better yet, stay limp, just do that.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, please take your seats. Our program will begin in 5 minutes. As a courtesy to our presenters and your fellow guests, please mute all cell phones and electronic devices. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, as a courtesy to our presenters and your fellow attendees, please mute all cell phones and electronic devices. Thank you.
Stand by for the Leilani logo.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Leilani Munter.
My name is Leilani Munter.
Hi, Leilani. Nice to meet you.
I am a professional race car driver and an environmentalist. Now I know what you're thinking. Race car driving is far from eco-friendly. I completely agree, and that is exactly what I intend to change.
When I die in the name of Tourette's, gonna go to the place that's the best.
I've always felt the need to go fast. When I was a little girl, it was horses. But then I got behind the wheel of a car.
Rebel, rebel, put on your dress. Rebel, rebel, your face is a mess.
This is the thing about racing, is it is so addictive.
At the age of 16, I received a letter from the state of Arizona saying that I was a danger to society after receiving an excessive number of speeding tickets. Apparently, they didn't appreciate my talent.
They threatened to take my license away, I think, within a year of me getting my license. I always was sort of racy. I always wanted to race people on the street.
So I saved my money and went to racing school. I was the only female in the class. Shortly after one of our races, a pro team owner came out of the stands to inform me I had just beaten one of his professional drivers. That conversation changed my life. From there, I never looked back.
Leilani Munter is flat hooked up. She has just passed five cars in the last lap and a half. Just talking to your spotter, Jacques Lazier, and he was pretty impressed with what you were doing. Tell us what happened.
I lost positions on the restart, but I was picking people off. I mean, I felt so good. My car was so solid.
Being a female in a male-dominated sport, I sometimes get extra attention.
You have that stereotype of, you know, is she here to drive, or is she just here? She's cute, and somebody wants to use her as a publicity stunt.
And people aren't always happy about it.
I did have a driver once and kind of get in my face and yell at me. And was really angry because some of the TV networks had come down to interview me. And he kind of was like, you know, I've been racing here for 10 years and I've never had them come down here and interview me. What's so special about you?
As I continue to prove myself in the Indy Pro Series, many of my critics will find themselves in the rear view. But there will always be those who suggest I maintain a low profile, especially off the track. But unfortunately, that is just not possible. Even as a child, I was in love with nature. I could never understand how people could be so abusive to something so beautiful. And yet I didn't understand the severity of what lied ahead and the role I would eventually play in trying to make a difference. Then my sister Natasha married a musician named Bob Weir. He played in a band you might have heard of called the Grateful Dead. Bob was also passionate about protecting the environment, and he used his celebrity to actually make a difference. It was then that I realized that my love for driving and my love for nature were meant to intersect. So every time I run a race in the Indy Pro Series, I buy an acre of rainforest, of endangered rainforest, to protect, to sort of offset the carbon footprint that I'm making by racing the car. I almost got hit by a butterfly. I've now become politically active, challenging the leaders in my sport and on Capitol Hill to act now to make the changes necessary to save our planet before it's too late. People are beginning to listen, but there is still so much work to be done, and I have to do my part. There is no question that race car driving is dangerous.
It's a tough sport. If it was easy, everybody would be doing it.
To be truly great, you have to be willing to put your foot on the gas at the very moment your body is begging you to hit the brakes. But I know that the more races I win, the more people will listen. And so I drive with a determination that comes from the deepest part of my soul, knowing there is more than one race to be won. I see the checkered flag, but my trophy cannot be held above my head. In the next 12 months, I will make racing history. I will fight to be one of a handful of women in the world to race at Indianapolis and Daytona, and I won't be happy with second place. I will invade corporate America and break new ground in bringing environmental sponsors to my sport. I will meet with other drivers one at a time, pleading with them to join me in the fight to bring all of American motorsports into a new era with the use of alternative fuels. As a former stuntwoman and photo double for Catherine Zeta-Jones, I will use my Hollywood ties to influence more celebrities to raise their voice. I will knock down doors in Washington, D.C., and I promise I will be heard. Along the way, I will raise a few eyebrows, hit a few walls, and undoubtedly lose a few battles as I continue to wage a war. But I will never, ever give up. My name is Leilani Munter. I am a race car driver and an environmentalist, and I will change the world.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody. It's really an honor to be here to speak with you today. You just got to see a glimpse of my driving experiences, and I've been lucky enough in my lifetime to drive some pretty cool cars. But I have to admit that after going into corners at entry speeds of over 200 miles an hour, I didn't think that I could ever get excited about a streetcar again. Thanks to Tesla Motors, I stand corrected. It's worth noting that the first time I ever drove a Tesla, it was Chris Payne's Silver Roadster for a film called Revenge of the Electric Car. And within just a few minutes, I found myself speaking to the police. That is a true story. That was a fun day. This is the first time in my life that I've been in love with a car that's not one of my race cars. I feel okay talking like that today because I know that I'm surrounded by people that feel the same way that I do. People who understand that Tesla is more than just a car. This is a revolution of the automotive industry, the beginning of a declaration of independence from fossil fuels. I'm glad it's happening in my lifetime, and I'm glad that I'm here to witness it. It's really a privilege that we are getting to be a part of this movement. By driving, owning, and being champions for Tesla, we are doing our small part to change the world, and Tesla couldn't have made it more fun to drive this kind of change. I know when you saw me on the list for today, some of you maybe were wondering how a race car driver could be an environmental activist. But before I was a driver, I was actually a biology graduate from the University of California in San Diego. And I'm really just your typical composting, rainwater collecting, vegetarian hippie chick. I just happen to drive race cars. ESPN magazine once called me the oxymoron, the tree-hugging race car driver. I'm an uncommon messenger in the environmental world, I know that. But I recently came across a quote by Earl Bakken that helped make some sense of it for me. He said, By all reckoning, the bumblebee is unsound and should not be able to fly. Yet the little bee gets those wings going like a turbojet and flies to every little plant its chubby little body can land on to collect all the nectar it can hold. Bumblebees are the most persistent creatures. They don't know they can't fly, so they just keep buzzing around. So much like the chubby bumblebee, I'm a race car driver that doesn't know I can't be an environmental activist. So I just keep buzzing around. My long, strange journey began with an accidental meeting at a racetrack and a stroke of luck. After graduating from college, I began working as a photo double for actress Catherine Zeta-Jones, and I used the money I made working for her to enroll in a racing school. Although I did not know it, while I was taking those very first laps around the track, there was a race team owner sitting in the stands watching me drive. He asked me if I had any interest in becoming a professional driver, and I explained that I didn't have the kind of money that it takes to be a race car driver. But he pointed out to me that not only did I have the fastest time that day, but I was also the only female driver. You might have a chance because that makes you different, he said. I think you should give it a shot. It took 15 minutes in that short conversation with a complete stranger about my potential and his vision of what I could become to change the course of my life forever. It took a lot of really hard work, a lot of phone calls, a lot of sponsor kits that ended up in the garbage can probably before they were even looked at. I had 1,000 doors slam in my face, but every time I got knocked down, I stood back up again, knocked the dust off my pants, and I went on to knock on the next door. Eventually, 9 months later, I heard my very first yes, and I ran my very first race. And when I heard the track announcer say, "Lady and gentlemen, start your engines." Thank you. I had already won, no matter where I finished in the race. Like any great love story, it didn't take long for me to fall. After my first two races, I decided to pour my heart and soul into becoming a professional driver. And when I broke the bad news to my family, I remember my father looking at me and in a very serious tone, asking me if this meant that graduate school was out of the question. And it was. So I packed up my little Volkswagen and I moved to North Carolina, which is the epicenter of NASCAR racing. I had no job, no race car, no race team, no sponsor, and I didn't know a single person in the state. All I had was my racing helmet and my health. I was definitely the odd one out. Not only was I a female driver in a male-dominated sport, but I was also what seemed like the only vegetarian in the state of North Carolina. I had more than a few people in NASCAR actually tell me they thought that this was why I was so short. The lack of meat in my diet had stunted my growth. It's safe to say that it was difficult for some of the old school NASCAR boys to take seriously a vegetarian female driver as a competitor, but it was about to get worse. Soon, it was not just my diet and my gender that was setting me apart from the rest of the racing community. Over the years, I've become increasingly concerned, like many others, about the damage that's being done to our environment. In 2006, I took my personal concerns public when I started a section on my website dedicated to environmental news. And in 2007, I announced my commitment to adopt and protect an acre of rainforest for every race that I run to offset the carbon footprint. Offsetting isn't a solution, but I had to do something about the unavoidable emissions of my car. The more that I learned about our environmental challenges, the more my racing website became covered in eco facts about renewable energy, alternative fuels, electric cars, green buildings, and environmental legislation. And the reaction that I got from the racing community and the general public was strong from both sides of the fence. I remember coming across an argument on a NASCAR forum in 2006. One member of the forum was very annoyed that I was promoting a movie called An Inconvenient Truth on my website. He called me all kinds of names and said that I was brainwashed by Al Gore. Others chimed in to agree. Another member questioned him how he could judge the movie if he hadn't actually seen it. The thread became very long, and people were posting back and forth. Some of them liked me, some of them hated me, but both sides were posting with passion. And when I got past the personal attacks on myself, I sat back and I thought, wow, I just started an argument about climate change on a NASCAR forum. I guarantee you this was the first time the people on that forum argued about the parts per million of carbon dioxide in our atmosphere. And that made me smile. I had started a dialogue, and that's the first step in creating change, to start a dialogue between the two sides. And that very simple thing became something very important to me. I had become a bridge between the environmentalists and the race fans, and even if some people didn't like me for it, what was happening on that forum was bigger than my racing career. I began lobbying for clean energy on Capitol Hill. I made 3 trips to Taiji, Japan, documenting the horrific dolphin slaughter that is exposed in the Oscar-winning documentary, The Cove. I made 2 trips to the BP oil spill in the Gulf of Mexico. And while I was there, I experienced a life-changing moment. 10 days after the Deepwater Horizon sank, I was in a small boat 75 miles away from the sunken rig, and I saw an unbelievable sight. There was crude oil floating from horizon to horizon for as far as the eye could see. Dead animals were floating in the oil, and it knocked the wind out of me. And from that moment on, I knew that I would never again buy a gasoline-powered car. My transition was complete. I had become an activist. I was told by many people in the racing world that I was making a big mistake, that as a driver I needed to shut up, drive the race car, and plug my sponsors. Marketing people warned me that by talking about political and environmental issues, I would alienate myself from companies that might want to sponsor my race car, companies with CEOs that might not believe in climate change. And you know what I told them? I said the same thing that I said years earlier to the people that told me girls can't drive race cars. I said, screw you. Watch me. I had made a very important decision, and that was that I was going to talk about what I believed in, even if it landed me on the sidelines of the racetrack. I had finally made it to a level in my sport where my races were airing on TV and I had an audience. And I knew I would be a fool to waste that opportunity. So if a sponsor didn't want to work with me because I promoted recycling and caring about the planet, then thanks, but no thanks. I don't want you on my race car anyway. And after I drew that line in the sand, something really interesting started to happen. I started to get calls from people who believed in the same things that I did. And in 2007, when I became the 4th woman in history to race in the Indy Pro Series, I had a company named Smart Papers on my race car. They are a leader in the recycled paper industry. I've raced for Operation Free, a coalition of veterans securing America with clean energy and getting the message out that our $1 billion a day habit on foreign oil is a national security threat to our country. At Daytona this year, I was honored to drive the first ever ocean awareness race car, carrying the colors of the Oscar-winning documentary, The Cove. So my race car has now become a 200-mile-per-hour billboard to advertise not products, but instead promoting shifts in our behavior for the future of our planet and our species. A couple years ago, one of my sponsors, Renewable Energy Native Energy, was criticized for their support. A disgruntled customer wrote on their company website, "You're promoting race car driving?" Tom Rawls, the Vice President of Marketing, responded on their website by saying this: "How does Native Energy reach people who are not already converts on the issue of climate change? Anyone who is engaged in any broad effort to speak to the public faces this question: do I speak to only friendly audiences, or do I face the doubters and the hostiles? If we only address those who already believe in what we do, then nothing changes. And if we only work with people who already agree with us, then who is going to change the minds of those who don't?" So this is my call to action for everyone here. I want all of us to start thinking outside the box, and instead of talking to each other, we have to go out and talk with people who are not on board yet. It's a more difficult conversation to have, but it is also the most important conversation, because this is how we create change. This is how we move the needle. And I've seen this change firsthand. I've had lifelong NASCAR fans ask me, "How do you go about adopting your acre of rainforest? I couldn't think of what to get my wife for her birthday, and I thought it might be cool to adopt an acre of rainforest in her name." Just because these fans love racing doesn't mean that they don't care about the earth. More than most, I think, the people in this room understand that liking cars and caring about the environment are not mutually exclusive events. Tesla is the perfect car for this demographic. They were built for people like us, people who don't believe that a car is just a way to get from point A to point B. No way. We want to have fun getting from point A to point B. And now we can do it without burning fossil fuels. It doesn't get any better than that. So why is reaching race fans important? Because racing is the number one spectator sport in America. It's number two on television, second only to the NFL. More people tune in to watch racing than watch baseball, basketball, and hockey combined. And of the 18 out of 20 top attended sporting events in the United States are auto races. One is the Indy 500, and the other 17 are NASCAR races. Nearly one in three Americans considers themselves a race fan, which is also why more Fortune 500 companies sponsor NASCAR than any other sport. So I'm now on a mission to green my sport. I'm hopeful that with a growing number of companies adopting green programs, that I will be able to find the corporate partners to help me continue using my race car to call to action millions of fans and get them to rethink their day-to-day habits for our planet. It's my 200 mile per hour eco-awareness program, and each time my race car hits the track, I will send an environmental call to action to the fans, because small changes, when multiplied by millions, make a big difference. I hope that my efforts will encourage the racing sanctioning bodies to increase their environmental initiatives, and I will not stop until I see every racetrack with a recycling program, every sponsor taking responsibility for their effect on the environment, every racing tire recycled, and every race car abandoning fossil fuels for electricity or renewables. This is my mission, and some people think I'm crazy, and I know this because they send me emails. But when I get discouraged, I remember these words from an old Apple Think Different commercial. Here's to the crazy ones, the misfits, the rebels, the troublemakers, the round pegs in the square holes, the ones who see things differently. They're not fond of rules and they have no respect for the status quo. You can quote them, disagree with them, glorify or vilify them, but the one thing that you cannot do is ignore them, because they change things. They push the human race forward, and while some may see them as crazy, we see genius, because the people who are crazy enough to think that they can change the world are the ones who do. You will probably find, as I have, that the more that you learn, the more your eyes open to your impact and the impact of everyone around you. And your awareness will be both a blessing and a curse. But with that burden of knowing comes a responsibility to educate those around you whose eyes have not opened yet. Charles Darwin once said, "It is not the strongest of the species that survives, nor is it the most intelligent. It is the one that is most adaptable to change." And so in the spirit of Charles Darwin, it is time for us to utilize our intelligence to adapt and to change the way that we are living and driving. This generation has been called upon to answer the most noble of duties, to ensure the survival of future generations by using the most basic of survival mechanisms, adaptation. And by being here today, I know that you guys are all a part of this evolution. This morning, I made another big step in my own evolution. I know that the kind of life that I choose to lead is defined by the moral choices that I make every single day, and I want to make choices that I'm proud of. The first thing that I did when I got out of bed this morning was write a Dear John letter of sorts. It went like this. Dear Oil, I am breaking up with you. It's not me. It's you. No, I don't want to be friends. Please don't call me, ever. And then I signed on to TeslaMotors.com and I ordered my Model S. From this day forward, I will never again own a car that burns fossil fuels. This is a choice that I can be proud of. As an environmentalist, driving fast cars has always been my guilty pleasure. And now, for the first time in my life, I can finally drive without guilt, the guilt of burning fossil fuels. And now the only time that I'll stop at gas stations is if I feel like flipping them off. Beyond my personal Tesla, next year you will also see me driving a very special Model S on the silver screen in a new film from the Academy Award-winning team that made The Cove. I can't reveal much more than that because this is a top secret Ocean's 11 kind of mission that we're on, and those of you who saw The Cove will understand what I'm talking about. But what I can tell you is that this is a one-of-a-kind Model S. There is not another car of any kind like it on the planet. And I can't wait for you guys to see what we're up to. You're gonna love it. Since being welcomed into this Tesla family and joining the forums and connecting with some of you on social media, I've been blown away by the effect that this car has on people. I saw it firsthand on the faces of North Carolina lawmakers when I was lobbying them to not restrict Tesla's right to sell cars in my state. I watched grown senators turn into teenage boys behind the wheel of the Model S. I saw it on the face of my sister, who has always been a cars are a way to get from point A to point B kind of person. And yet, after I brought her to Menlo Park for a test drive, she promptly ordered herself an S and then began to text me, counting down the days till her car arrived. Six more days, she would text me. I see the excitement all over the forums and in some hilarious comments. There was one particular thread that caught my eye, and it really summed up the Tesla phenomenon for me. The person that started the thread on teslamitters.com called it Tesla psychosis. Some of you know this thread. It was written by a man in Europe who was anxiously awaiting the arrival of his Model S. He contemplated his addiction to all things Tesla and then concluded, "I'm buying into more than a car here. I'm buying into an entire philosophy." He asked the other members of the forum if his obsession would pass once his car was delivered. But then his post took on a more serious note when he wrote this. "Something else struck me when I ordered my Model S. One of my kids died a few years ago, and life has been nothing but grim since. Losing her took all the joy out of life, all the color out of living. Ordering the Model S has woken in me a sense of excitement that I'd forgotten existed. So I'm indulging in my obsession. It may be some kind of psychosis, but I say, bring it on." The forum responded with pages of support and reassurance that his obsession was normal, and that they too had it, and that it would not go away once his car was delivered, but would in fact get even worse. Here were some of the replies. "We are all so emotionally invested here because Tesla is about hope. We all instinctively feel it. A new and better time is beginning. This car is absolutely a life-changing event. I have never felt anything for any auto that I have owned until the Tesla. The Model S is the best therapy that money can buy. Tesla is about hope for a better future for our children. I never imagined spending this much on a car, but this is more than a car. This is hope. This car, this company, and its vision means a lot to me." And some of the comments on the obsession were a little more comical, like this short comment. "All I can say is that I sat in the car in the garage for an hour the first night that I had it, Mike." Some people may think we are crazy. All this fuss over a car. And maybe we are, just a little. But we know that this is about something much deeper than a car company. Our Teslas are a way for us to tell the rest of the world there is a better way. I couldn't be happier to be a part of this crazy family of ours. I'm glad that Tesla psychosis is real, spreading fast, and I'm so happy that I have it. I think this is only the beginning, and I would say the sky's the limit. But considering that SpaceX is going to take us to Mars, I think it's safe to say there is no limit. And in case anybody from SpaceX is here, I would like to mention that after I hang up my racing suit, I would gladly trade it in for a spacesuit. My name is Leilani Munter, and I am a woman. I'm a race car driver and a biologist. I'm a political activist and a wife. I'm a daughter, a sister, and a scuba diver. And while I strive to do each of these things to the betterment of myself, on my very best days, I'm a catalyst for change outside of myself. And that is the core reason why I exist. I pledge to each of you today to use my voice as a driver to spread environmental awareness and encourage change as much as I can. As a woman in racing, I must warn you that the odds are stacked against me. If you listen to statistics, as a woman, I am actually, funnily enough, more likely to be sent into space than I am to ever race in the top level of NASCAR. But like the chubby bumblebee that doesn't know it can't fly, I just keep buzzing around. And so I hope that each of you here will be a bumblebee with me. And with our Teslas helping us buzz around this little blue-green planet of ours, together, we will change the world. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks. Thank you. Thanks for having me. Hey, Elon.
Wow. I finally got the mic, and I'm not going to talk very long, I promise. So, yes, I'm going to introduce Elon. I'm not going to use up a lot of time, but I've been asked to ask a couple questions of the audience. How many of you have a Tesla product at home? Okay. How many of you have sold at least one Tesla to somebody else? How many of you have sold five or more to someone else? 10? We got a few? Eric's got his hand. 20 or more? Anyone? All right, yeah, okay. Congrats. So I promise, I was going to write a really nice intro for Elon, and I realized everybody here knows far more probably than I do, and you don't want to hear me talk. So Elon Musk.
Wow, I haven't even said anything. Well, first of all, I'd just like to say I thought that Leilani's talk was incredible. That was really moving. Wow. And it's actually great to hear stuff like that because, you know, when I spend most of my day actually thinking about what's wrong with the car and what's wrong with the company and. These are all the things we need to fix, and I think most people probably have a good experience with the car, but then every now and again, you know, just statistically speaking, when you're making thousands of cars, every now and again one of them isn't very good, and then we end up torturing some poor customer, and then I get the long story of like, oh, I love your car, and this is what you did to me, and it's like, and I feel so bad. And you were trying to, anyway. So I spend my time sort of thinking about these sort of, three sigma bad situations and whatnot. So it's really nice to hear the positive stories and see sort of the plus side. Let's see. I thought actually I'll say a few things, but then I think what I think is most engaging is really to have a more of a conversation, kind of a back and forth, and that's sort of what I had in mind. I mean, as you guys probably know, the Tesla didn't organize this. This is sort of a spontaneous thing from sort of Tesla owners, And you know, we're sort of here to support, but it actually wasn't created by us. But what I thought would be good to do is to kind of get a back and forth, kind of just to hear what you think. What do you think we should be doing in the future, doing differently? I'm always interested in hearing, like, you know, what are we doing wrong? Without being too negative, but something tells me the audience is positively disposed to Tesla. So we're trying to figure out what are the things we should be doing differently or better or focusing on, and just kind of the thought I had was to really have kind of a town hall, kind of back and forth sort of conversation. Obviously the goal of Tesla is really to accelerate the advent of sustainable transport. So there are plenty of car companies in the world. There's not really a need for a new car company, you know, just another gasoline car company or anything like that. But there is a need for a company that's pushing for sustainable transport. You know, something that, if you extrapolate into the future, you can see a sort of a positive, bright future. And I actually didn't think that it would be necessary to do something like Tesla, because I thought at one point, when there was the EV1 and the original electric RAV4, that things were kind of headed in the right direction, and I thought for sure GM would do like the EV2 and the EV3 and everything would be fine. And then of course that's not what happened. As soon as California changed its regulations, GM recalled the EV1 and crushed them in a parking, in a junkyard, and then people actually held a candlelit vigil to be, as though if someone was, you know, it was sort of a capital punishment type of thing. And which just amazed me, because I mean, it's really quite rare for people to hold a candlelit vigil about a product, you know. It's really unusual. So it was clear that the forcing function needed to come from a company, a new company. And we created Tesla, starting off obviously with the Tesla Roadster, and in the beginning people said, well, you're not going to be able to make a car that looks good and goes fast and has long range, and then we did, and then they said, well, nobody's going to buy it. Thank you for buying. By the way. I'm really deeply appreciative of everyone that bought a Tesla, because without people like you, Tesla wouldn't be around. I mean, it needs people that are forward thinking, that are willing to take a chance on a new product for a new company, and that's critical to making it work. So we did the Roadster, and we got a lot of flack from people that thought, well, that the reason me and JB and Martin, Mark and Ian, and everyone else, the reason that we'd created the company, they thought, was because we felt that there was a shortage of sports cars for rich people. So that's why I wrote that blog, several years ago, just to explain, like, no, that wasn't actually the reason that we created the company. But whenever you've got something that's the first version of the technology, and it's in low production volume, whatever you do, it's going to be expensive. So, and people are only prepared to pay sort of a lot for something like a sports car. Now with the Model S, we're coming to step two of the plan, which is kind of a medium-priced, medium-volume car. And then the step three we want to get to as soon as possible, which is low-priced, high-volume car. That's where we're headed. But obviously, vital to all of that is our customers that are willing to buy the cars like the Model S and support the company along the way. So we want to make sure that we're sort of doing the smart things to get there, and just looking for feedback and ideas, and also happy to answer any questions. Bearing in mind the obvious constraint that as a public company, anything I say will be pounced upon by the media. Even if it's like a throwaway comment. In fact, Like, there was a Bloomberg article earlier this week where the reporter was asking me, so are you just going to make, what kind of models are you going to make in the future? And I said, oh, we're going to make every mode of transport you could possibly imagine. And I said that jokingly, and then he quoted me. I'm like, no. anyways, he said he would put a correction in there. I got to get after him about that. I do think that we will be shipping over 800 cars a week by the end of next year. I think that's probably good. Yeah. And I think that's probably a pretty reasonable assumption because, you know, we're sort of shipping on the order of 400 cars a week to North America, and I think there's going to be a pretty significant interest in the Model S in Europe and in Asia. So those markets are collectively actually bigger than North America. So it seems like 800 a week would be a reasonably safest assumption on volume. All right, well, let's just dive right into the conversation and the questions. Should we start there?
Yeah, why don't we start on this side, and one question, not repeated multiple, even though I know everyone has a lot, and we'll just work from side to side. And Elon, if you could let us know when just one more question, we'll wrap it up at that point.
All right, sure.
Okay. Hi, Elon. Yeah. Cole Wilcox from Longboard Asset Management. I'm one of the people who sold more than 20 cars.
Thank you. Excellent.
But I'm also a huge shareholder of the company and sparked a short squeeze in the security. So this question isn't really relevant to me because I've already done quite well. But for everybody in the audience and future shareholders, what are you guys going to do in terms of an official economic incentive for your single greatest customers and to kind of fuel the feedback loop as you go forward in time to expand all over the world? And that's my question.
Let me make sure I understand the question correctly. So you're saying, are you suggesting Tesla should come up essentially with some kind of perhaps reward system for customers that have been instrumental in selling a significant number of cars? Is that correct?
I'm saying that if you had an economic incentive for your customers, that they would do more than what they're currently doing on their own, and it would be good for the company.
I think you're probably correct about that.
Yeah.
So, from my PayPal days, we spent a lot of time thinking about how to create a viral growth engine, which was, and I mean, the keys to that are, of course, reducing the friction of buying and reducing the friction of referral, so making it really easy to buy and refer, and then creating an incentive. And I think one of the keys is to create an incentive both for the person doing the referral as well as the buyer. And that way, if by referring someone, the both parties actually benefit, then it works well. So it's possible we would introduce something like that in the future. But the key thing for right now is we've got to. I mean, our issues right now are actually not so much demand generation as they are production related. So, which is not as easy to solve as it may seem. In order for a production to grow, we have to have the whole supply chain move in cadence, because there are several thousand unique parts in the car, and even if some of those parts, even if just a few of them are missing, then we can't raise production, because then people are missing parts of their car and they get very upset about that. sometimes it can be the most trivial thing. Like at one point there was a shipment of trunk carpet that was coming from a supplier in Mexico that there was a drug shootout at the border. I kid you not, this is like a real thing. And then we had to pile up cars in the yard to wait for a new shipment of trunk carpet. But now, trunk carpet obviously is not going to be a long-term constraint because there's, you know, it's not that one can produce large amounts of that. But there are some of the tougher things. I think one of the bigger challenges for us is going to be lithium-ion cell production. So we're working with our main partner Panasonic on ramping up lithium-ion cell production, and I think actually that's probably going to be the main constraints on our production growth for a few years to come. Because we need a lot of battery. So I think we'll consider engaging sort of a viral growth engine, but we first need to address our production constraints.
Okay, thank you.
All right. So I think I'll alternate.
Hi, I'm Georgiana Elizabeth Penny Keys, and I'm a very small shareholder, very happy, and from Albuquerque, New Mexico. And I just wanted to say how much, from the very bottom of my heart, I appreciate everything that you have done and are doing.
Thank you.
And I'm sure we'll do in the future, which I'm looking forward to now. And I can't say this with enough emphasis, but I really felt like there was no future. And you've provided that for me, you and the entire Tesla team. And I can't thank you enough for that. And it's only recently I realized just how deeply it's impacted me on just a day-to-day level. And I think that Leilani's comments about this company as hope is really, really true. And I couldn't think of any way to say thanks except my little T-shirt
and
a little bottle from some friends of mine in Sonoma County. They're starting their own.
Sure, you're most welcome. Yeah. All right. Anybody got a bottle opener?
Are you serious?
And I need a glass.
Cheers. It's his turn, but I'll go while he's opening the bottle. I just want to say thank you.
Oh, where are you?
Oh, go ahead, ask. Go ahead.
That's what you call livening things up. It's alive. All right.
So, hi. My name's Greg Rose. My wife Pat and I own a car that I believe you fondly referred to as Pinky.
All right.
In the factory. And my question is extremely simple. I'm going to phrase my question in the form of a question. Unfortunately. The main reason for that is that
Leilani... It's like Leilani, Guide to the Galaxy.
Leilani got there first by basically hinting that she wants a job with you, and I'm not going to hint about it, damn it. I want a job with you, and how do I get one?
I'm very intrigued by the possibility. All right, let's go. Okay, well, sorry, was that a question or the question of the question? Oh, how do you get a job? What sort of job would you like?
Well, so I run a 230-person R&D group for Qualcomm, and I've got basic physics, mathematics, I'm a cryptographer, I manage people.
Okay.
You know, what have you got?
I'd recommend... there are a bunch of things on the website.
Yeah, I've tried. I've tried that. I never get the call back. You know.
Okay. Well, let's see.
I admit this is shameless self-promotion.
Okay. Well, we make cars, so it would have to be something related to making cars.
Rockets are closer to San Diego.
Okay. So you've gone to the SpaceX website too?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. I'm too much of a generalist and too old, I think.
Well, no, it's not an old thing. It's mostly one just needs to do sort of something that helps build rockets or cars.
Or conduct research, or build hyperloops or something like that. I've also started three companies.
But
not as successfully as some people.
Okay, well, if you send an email to Elon Musk office at TeslaMotors.com, then I will forward it to HR, and maybe that'll be helpful. Okay.
Hi there, Albert, Model S owner. Don't own stock, maybe one day. But just wanted to say thanks for the car.
You're welcome.
It's been really great. I was wondering, what do you see as the biggest challenge for Tesla in the next several years?
The biggest challenge for Tesla is, I think, scaling up. We've got to figure out how to be, get bigger without losing focus or kind of, when companies get big, sometimes they get this sort of like big company-itis. And the tonal corporate and that kind of thing. As you can see, I'm trying to avoid that.
Very successfully.
Right. I think it's mostly about scaling up. And the thing is that right now, even though we're making, I don't know, somewhere in the order of, call it an annualized rate of 25,000 or more a year on an annualized basis. That's still a very tiny drop in the bucket, because in order to move to a sustainable future, there have to be a really huge number of electric cars made, and every year there are about roughly 90 million cars made a year, and there's an existing kind of install base of almost two billion cars, so. At our current production rates, that would take a very long time. So we have to figure out how to scale up in a very significant way, and then we need to figure out how to scale up battery production and the things that are kind of unique to electric cars. We want to try to do that as fast as we reasonably can without impairing the product quality and still being able to sort of service things well and that kind of thing. So I think it's mostly about that. The single biggest challenge is probably scaling battery production. The sheer number of battery plants that need to get built is the scale is quite staggering. And I should mention, though, it's not going to be a question of lithium shortage. Sometimes there are these articles about we're going to run out of lithium. Trust me, there's a lot of lithium on Earth, and the amount of lithium mass in a battery pack is maybe 1-2%. So it's more like this sort of salt on the salad. But it is going to require some just gargantuan factories. And for a while, I thought that. When Tesla showed that you can make a compelling electric car with long range and all these good features, and that if you did, that people would buy it, I thought for sure that the car industry would look at that and say, oh, now we've seen the light, and we're going to go make electric cars too. This is not the case. It's quite shocking, actually.
Good news for Tesla.
The thing is that the reason I'm doing this is because I think we need to accelerate the advent of sustainable transport. I'd much rather that there were competitors to Tesla than weren't. But amazingly, the only action I see from the big car companies are that which would satisfy the minimum regulatory requirements. In order for them to take action, they have to feel competitive pressure. So that means that I think Tesla's got to scale up production in a significant way. And when they feel competitive pressure, then I think that they'll be more inclined to produce electric cars.
Thanks.
All right.
Phil Stillman. I'm a Model S signature owner. I just wanted to say thank you for not restricting the use of the screen while we're driving, which so many cars do, or making us print a little legal thing that says, I promise not to use the screen. I mean, that's ridiculous.
I agree.
I love that feature.
Yeah.
But my question is, when are we going to have a Model S Hot Wheels?
Oh, good question. I actually was wondering that myself. you know, well, Hot Wheels is they're owned. I think they're owned by Mattel or one of the toy companies. And they actually have one for the Roadster.
Yeah.
And but I was asking that question myself, and apparently they tend to make them only for sports cars or cars they think that people want. But I was like, I think people would want the Model S. One too. So I think. Yeah, maybe some letter of encouragement to them to do it would be.
All right, you guys write a letter to Mattel.
Yeah, exactly. Like, yeah.
Hi, I'm Bill from Minneapolis, and I'm about to make a reservation on my first Tesla car. One of the rare people here that doesn't own one. First of all, you haven't been around this group, but their passion is amazing for Tesla and the environment. Congratulations, everybody. I've been struck by the different types of people I've seen here. There's people that have done well with the stock and now have rewarded themselves with the car. But I've also been struck by the innovator, logical thinker that's gone from an average, inexpensive car to the Model S. And how they've gone from kind of logic to this emotional I'm a kid again. So it's been very, very exciting. But really, what I want to talk about is in talking to those people, I've heard about their spouses and how they were laggards and late majorities. And yet, the minute the car came in, I'm hearing stories about there's custody every other week. That's
No, actually, I've heard that many times where, you know, it's somebody's wife or husband's like, no, it's an electric car, and, you know, who knows how those things will work, and is that company going to survive, and blah, blah, blah. And then they get the car, and then it's like, hey, where's my car? it's like, weren't you the one saying we shouldn't get it? No, now you're not giving it back to me.
Yeah, and that struck me, and it's actually what my question is about. Women in particular. You've innovated the auto industry, or you're innovating it. You're innovating where the car is sold and how it's sold. How do you view women? Women probably...
I love women.
I'll toast to that.
Women in the future. Here's my question. Women hate buying cars. They buy 50% of the cars. Well, not Tesla, but the general car experience they do not like.
Right.
You're coming out with the Model X, which will truly appeal to them. Are you going to do anything special to really leverage women? Like, you know, Leilani, her passion is unbelievable. Have you thought about how you leverage them? They're not as techy. They're not going to respond to the story. Wait. I'm not... Boy, I've got something going here. I don't want to take the mic over here.
I think that may be a bit of a broad brushstroke.
Yeah, I'm not here to... My point is that shoppers have different needs and they may not be innovators into the technical thing. Are you looking at how you can leverage the women population, get more of them to pay attention to you as they're walking by your stores, and really look at them as... how you can help advance the industry. I mean, if it had been all women that signed the petition for the White House, I think more would have happened.
Well, I think we have a fairly significant sort of female support.
That's clear.
It's this wine, in fact, that I'm drinking. It came from women. So, I think there's... I mean, there's probably more that we could be doing, and I think it's probably fair to say that you know, although there are a lot of women that actually that do buy the Model S, there's probably going to be a slightly higher percentage that buy the Model X, and generally when I've talked to women they like a higher position when they're driving, that tends to be a preference. And whereas the Model S is intended for occasional seven passenger driving, the The Model X is intended for frequent seven-passenger driving, and has as sort of even more storage space and that kind of thing. So I think actually, as we sort of refine the Model X, we're going to be soliciting input from women to make sure that they like what it's doing, and that the double hinged gull wing door or falcon wing door, we want to make sure that it is both obviously really safe, but also perceptually that the perception of it is also one that's comforting. But we're always looking for feedback, and I do feel as though we actually have gotten quite a bit of support on all fronts from women thus far.
Yeah, and just to clarify, I'm really I have no chance of getting out of this room. No, I just want to clarify that what I meant was that the way.
All right.
Let me just finish. What I meant to say was the way that auto dealers treat women is unacceptable. That's my point.
Well, I think I think the way they treat all people is not great.
Good point.
But yeah. Oh, sorry.
Robert Tew from Chicago. A pleasure to finally meet you. I have my S about a few months. Odd question, very simple one. Putting myself in your shoes and being in this room, maybe a unique event, they probably do this for other brands maybe, but I think it's unique. How do you feel about being here? Do we make you at all nervous or anything? Like,
should I be nervous?
I don't know.
I feel as though I'm in a friendly crowd.
Expectations or anything? I mean,
I didn't really know what to expect. I mean, I thought it would be rather pro Tesla, but but no, I feel pretty at ease, I think.
Well, glad you feel that way. Okay, cheers.
All right.
Hi, Ellen. My name is Bob Fitzgerald. I'm from Princeton, New Jersey, a Roadster owner. Earlier today, a number of us were together in a breakout talking a little bit about the Roadster. And the question is, we all understand that your focus and Tesla's focus in the next few years has to be on X and Generation 3, but we're hoping that there'll still be some capacity to do some nice things for the base of the Roadster owners, maybe HPCs at supercharger stations or some of them, and perhaps refreshes of the battery pack down the line. Do you think that with there's still limitations on your resources, do you think that may be possible?
Well, we are going to do something special for Roadster owners next year. So I can't say what that is, but it's going to be. I think it'll be pretty cool.
Thank you.
But the key thing we've got to get through in the balance this year is the European introduction, which is going on right now. The rollout of the supercharger stations. There's just a phenomenal amount of work going on. Throughout the country and in Europe with the supercharger stations, and then we've got to finish the design and engineering of the Model X. And as we get through that, which hopefully we'll get through the bulk of that in the next 6 months, then I think we'll do something for our Roadster owners next year.
Great. Last comment is just between the work that you've done with Tesla and with SpaceX, I personally think your biggest accomplishment is you've made it possible again to dream really big.
Great.
Thanks for that.
Hi, Elon. I'm John Younger, and I have to say,
pour some more wine here.
Absolutely.
I'm telling you, this is going to get better and better as
it is. The marital bliss problem and the custody issue got solved for us with my bride of 12 years by getting a second Tesla. So
excellent.
With the Roadster and the S, it's easier. As a fellow CEO, I understand you have to look at the resources at your fingertips and use them to their optimal level.
Right.
You're sitting in front of a resource.
Yep.
What can we do besides building battery factories to help?
Well, I think you're doing a lot already, which is to sort of spread the good word. and to sort of show to show your friends and family and people you encounter the Model S, and for a lot of people out there who are not early adopters and who most people are not early adopters and new technology it scares most people at least a little bit. Anything you do to make people believe that that electric cars are the future and it's the way to go and it's worth taking a chance, I think is actually incredibly valuable.
We got that done.
All right.
So just keep thinking of other things we can do.
Thank you. So.
Howard Horn from White House Station, New Jersey. I realize that Tesla sort of spans consumer electronics and automobiles, and in consumer electronics it's been very easy for manufacturers to in essence go down market. That's what's expected. In automobiles it's been much harder, and really the success stories have been auto manufacturers that go up market. Ones that try and go down market end up sometimes not existing. Given also that Tesla is sort of used to dealing with customers who are willing to accept being early adopters and that which goes along with it, as you get more upmarket or more mass market rather, people may be less willing to accept that. Given those two circumstances, how do you and your previously stated difficulty with ramping up and buying batteries, how do you plan to address that?
Well, I do get a lot of questions about sort of brand and brand strategy and all that. I mean, I actually don't really pay much attention to such things. I mean, I just view it as there need to be a very large number of electric cars made because we've got to change out the base of hydrocarbon burning cars, and so we just need to do that. And I don't really care if it means that we have a less premium brand or anything like that.
But it's difficult for the premium brand to go down market. People look at this as a rich man's car, and getting them into the stores, I think, will be very hard. Just as it's difficult, BMW to sell a one, they it's easier for them to sell a three and a five.
Yeah, I'm not quite. I mean, I guess we'll make the third generation car, which it's not going to be super cheap, but it's going to be sort of in the $35,000 range. Although when you take into account the savings from gasoline, it's actually going to be effectively like close to a $25,000 car. And I think there probably will be some increase in gasoline prices over time. And
you think?
It should be effectively like buying a gasoline car that costs in the 20s of thousands of dollars. We're gonna do it, so it may or may not be successful, but we're gonna do it anyway. So.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Rahul Sanad from Los Angeles, and I have a Tesla watch.
we do not make Tesla watches, as you point out.
It's electric. But, okay. It seems like we're on the brink of a pretty big transformation that will be driven by electric vehicles, possibly solar power generation,
absolutely.
Autopilot, driverless technologies, and maybe even like hyperloopy things. But if you extract that out like 10 or 15 or 20 years, like what do you think the really big impacts on kind of society and life as we know it will be? Like, is it, that our cars are going to drop us off and go park themselves in suburbs?
Right.
Or like just what do you think the real big, material effects kind of long term are?
Well, I mean, the first order of business is definitely to ensure that transport and energy are sustainable. And it's somewhat, obviously, it's tautological, because if it's unsustainable, then independent of any environmental impacts, there will be economic collapse as the scarcity becomes significant. So the first order of business, and the reason we haven't sort of done too much on the kind of autopilot or self-driving car front, is because it's very important to transition to electric, and then of course to have sustainable power generation, which I think is is solar. And solar is really just indirect fusion. I think the kind of indirect fusion and electricity generation and electric cars are the right solution for the future. One could extrapolate as far into the future as one can imagine and say, okay, that all would work. So I think we all need to transfer all modes of transport to electric, with the ironic exception of rockets, which I wish could go electric, but it's just really difficult to get away from Newton's third law. Although I do think it'll be possible to generate the fuel with solar power. And the next generation fuel that we'll be using at SpaceX is methane. So you can generate CH4 with the CO2 and H2O, and that's going to be important anyway for refueling on Mars. I think sustainability is the most important thing. Then in terms of adding in kind of an autopilot function to the car, the way I look at sort of that autopilot or self-driving is that it's essentially active safety in the limit. So as you improve active safety features like active cruise control, lane departure, reading street signs and so forth, and you keep doing that, then eventually you get to where the car can pretty much be on autopilot for most, if not all, of the journey. That is something that we're going to be working on in a big way in the next few years. But it's like I said, it's sort of a B priority relative to scaling up electric transport. It will probably change how things work. Like you won't need to, like, it's nice not having to go find a parking spot, and there are probably ways that it'll change that are hard to envision today. But I think the first order of business, the really pressing one, is to make sure that we're minimizing the amount of carbon that we're putting into the atmosphere, because that's we're running this crazy chemical experiment, which is a very, very difficult thing to reverse, and I think it's really important that we stop running that chemical experiment. So.
Thank you.
Hi, Elon. I'm Bob Wilson from San Jose. Thank you for building my dream car, the first American car I ever wanted to buy. Regarding the Model S, you have a room full of experts here. And to steal a phrase, tell us something we don't know. One thing about the past, a past design decision that you haven't talked about previously, and something that's coming in the near future in our Model S's that we might not have heard about yet.
Wow, okay. Vino Veritas. There sure were a lot of adventures along the way in creating the Model S. Adventure being the best word I can possibly imagine for. Some of them were quite difficult and nightmarish. There's so many. I might have to think about that for a bit to sort of pick something, because I also know that anything I say can and will be used against me.
Not
so
by us.
I'm a little cautious about what I say. Yeah, I know you guys won't, but there's some journalists, some that sort of thing. There were all sorts of esoteric engineering things that we had to do. I can say, what a lot of people actually maybe don't realize is that the primary optimization, or the thing we focused on more than anything with the Model S, was safety. And in fact, when we did the unveiling of the first car at the Fremont factory, I started off my presentation talking about safety and showing crash videos. That didn't seem to resonate too much with the crowd. So I sort of didn't talk about it all that much after that. But I think of anything that we're actually most proud of with Model S, is what we've done on the safety side. To the best of my knowledge, there's never been a permanent injury in the Model S. No fatalities that I'm aware of, and not even a permanent injury. So maybe somebody got some bruises. Now, statistically speaking, that's unlikely to remain the case. When you have tens of thousands of cars and hundreds of millions of miles and that kind of thing. But so far, so good. We really did everything we possibly could think of to improve safety. And maybe I'll sort of write a blog piece this summer to talk about what we've done in that regard and sort of get into some of the engineering details. But in order to achieve the highest possible safety rating, we did have to do some sort of kludgy things in the car. For example, the B pillar, whereas the car is almost entirely, the body and chassis are aluminum, the B pillar has a high strength boron steel insert in order to improve the side crash protection, which is really unnecessary because if we'd properly designed the B pillar, we could have done the whole job with just aluminum and made it a lot simpler. And it's also got these expensive aerospace grade bolts and all sorts of things. So that's something that we could probably make lighter and maybe even better with a redesign.
For the future.
Yeah, exactly. People won't really, you won't notice it. It's kind of, you can't see it really, but the car will just be slightly lighter and maybe it's sort of slightly better in that regard. All the adventures that we had on the crash side are other things that we did. Oh, and I should also mention that in the rear, if you get the third row, we have a double bumper system. So there's actually an aluminum bumper and a steel bumper, and the threshold is that is to ensure that if the car is impacted in the rear at highway speeds, that any third row occupants do not suffer permanent injury.
And as far as something coming?
I think if I say something, then people are like, oh, I must not buy a Model S because something else is coming.
Something we might be able to upgrade to in the future in our Model S's.
Upgrade to, Let me think about that. I'll have to think about that and have some more wine.
Okay.
Aloha again, Elon.
Hey.
I'm from Hawaii, and Tesla is loved in Hawaii. We have lots and lots and lots of owners.
Great.
Island economies are particularly affected by a lot of the climate change issues and the
sure.
price of oil. And so I know you're focused right now on Europe, which I hope it goes great. I think it will go great.
Yeah.
But there's about 25,000 island economies that are meaningful around the world, everywhere from the Canary Islands to the Hawaiian Islands. When you have time, and we have resources, we'd sure love a showroom in some of these islands and a service center. I know that in Hawaii, where some of us have cars, it would be a great service. And you know, we have 8 million tourists that come to Hawaii from both the east and the west. And I mentioned this at the stockholders meeting 2 years ago. Just want to keep lobbying for resources for the islands. Thank you very much.
Duly noted.
I'll bring you some macadamia nuts to go with
right.
your wine in just a moment.
I've eaten way too many. In fact, I love macadamia nuts. So I've eaten particularly the chocolate-covered ones. Those are really good.
Yeah, I got some of those in the
room. But I believe we actually have a service center in Hawaii. Where is Jerome? where is our Hawaii service center? In Honolulu. Okay.
When did it open?
All right. So, yeah.
Good afternoon. My name is Doug Bullard. I'm a Model S owner and shareholder. So in a past career, I used to be a space shuttle design engineer. I know how difficult it is to get something up into orbit. And you've done, that's something that was basically considered impossible for any startup company to actually do and do well. You've done that, and you've done a second impossible thing of getting a car company started and making a product that basically just hit the ball out of the park on the first big release of your product. Given that there were extreme challenges in both of these companies, which was harder for you to deal with? Because space travel has its own set of technical challenges, right. But commercial automobiles, you have to deal with all the legal, you know, many 50 states, dealers, associations, all that stuff. What were some of the, what was harder to do?
That's a tricky one to answer. I think the nature of the challenge varies between space and automotive. In the space situation, it's almost entirely a technical challenge.
There are no lawyers in space.
Right. There are regulations that one has to follow, of course, in order to for the FAA and of course if you've worked on shuttle stuff, you know that NASA has quite a significant body of regulation.
NORAD,
yeah, exactly. So we have to meet basically the FAA, NASA, and Air Force requirements for on the space side. But still, it's not as the law and regulations are not as significant in space as they are with automotive. There is not really kind of a sales and service and distribution problem with rockets. We don't have to deal with that. So that's why it's sort of more a greater percentage of the problem is just engineering, whereas in cars you've got, as I said, you've got to deal with all of the nuances of 50 states and dozens of countries, and then you've also got to deal with the fact that the product is out in the field, whereas with the rocket we don't have to worry about whether other people can use the rocket, that's the sort of nature of the challenge. But I think that they're really both quite hard, and it's difficult to say whether one is really harder than the other.
Well, congratulations on your success in both.
All right, thanks.
Hi, Elon. My name is Vernon Huang. I'm a local Model S owner. I have a software update feature request that a lot of people in this room may not have thought of. I was out with my wife and another couple on her birthday, and we were struck by a reckless driver. Everyone was fine. The Model S held up well. You know, nobody had any severe injuries. The M5 didn't fare so well.
Oh, yeah. Actually, I think I saw the photos of that. In fact,
I tweeted you and you tweeted me back. That was pretty cool.
Yeah. It was kind of crazy. Obviously, one doesn't want to make a marketing event out of such a thing, but, the M5 was destroyed.
I have the dash cam video if you're interested in seeing it. I'm not sharing it out electronically.
Sure.
But my request is that the car mechanically protected us really, really well.
Yeah.
And I was wondering if you'd heard any requests for the software to proactively detect these kind of catastrophic events and do things like turn off the radio, turn off the buzzers that are going off and distracting me because I know the airbags are in my face and something's wrong. And maybe put up a center screen with shortcuts, things like dialing 911, putting the car in tow mode, putting on the parking brake.
Oh, that's a good suggestion.
And tips too on things like preserving the 12-volt battery, because eventually my 12-volt battery died and then my car kind of shut down and had to be dragged. But and I didn't have the presence of mind and all the craziness to know that if I jumped the battery that we could probably turn some of the systems back on. That's the feature request I have.
I think actually that's a good suggestion. We'll do that.
Hi, I'm Richard from Santa Cruz. And as an aside, my wife was very successful in a high-tech field and loves to buy cars. My question is one to which I got a negative response at the factory. And I know you have capacity issues, but I'm wondering when we're going to see a Tesla truck. The potential to reduce carbon emissions In light and large trucks, especially commercial, not just pickup trucks, there's a tremendous opportunity there to reduce the carbon footprint.
I totally agree with that. I'm quite keen on building a truck. And I think there's a lot one can do with truck technology. One of the things I think that should be present in trucks is something like an air suspension that dynamically adjusts the load and sort of keeps the angle of the car of the truck correct and the ride height even and adjusts the damping in real time. Because the challenge you have with any vehicle where there's a big difference, a big potential difference between the minimum and maximum load, is that the suspension is always wrong, and usually wrong by a lot. When I was driving an F-250 down the 405 one day, and honestly, that thing was resonating at the 405. The little ridges between the, and I was like, man, my teeth are going to rattle out of my head. It's like. But if you put load in it, it's fine. But if you're empty, it's not. So I think it'd be good to do that, and then obviously to make it light, and really handle well. And again, that's where like having a battery pack low can improve the center of gravity. So I think it's possible to create a really well handling truck, that feels good at any load point. That'd be really great. So.
You've obviously given it some thought. Thanks a lot.
You're welcome.
Okay, we are going to take one more question. No, but wait, with Elon. Jerome will be coming up next, and if you want to stay at the mic, you're still going to have a chance. And Elon, if you want to take more questions, I've just been asked to... give okay. A little space.
Well, I think it'd be great to actually have Jerome join me on stage. Come right on.
This is from the attendees here.
Oh, wow, cool.
A big thank you, Tesla. You've all seen it, but we'd like to take back over the factory night, but this is for both of you. Okay.
All right.
Cool. Pardon me? Do you want to introduce
me? Yeah, absolutely.
Okay.
First of all, thank you very much for the thank you. We'll put that prominently in the factory. Jerome has been instrumental in the creation of the Model S and served as basically the overall program director. And then I actually asked him to step into the service role and kind of re-engineer service. A key part of the team and knows the Model S inside out and backwards. So any ideas and suggestions you have for improving the car or kind of the service experience, Jerome can answer and respond. And actually, we want to actually take feedback and do things. So it's not just like say stuff and Tesla doesn't do anything. Like we want to actually do stuff. So. I'll keep answering questions for a bit, and maybe some of those questions can be answered by Jerome. And then I'm going to have to head out with my kids, who I think are maybe reaching the end of their patience. All right, so go ahead.
Hi, Elon. My name's Warren. I live in Florida. I'm here with my wife, Darcy. And I just want to thank you for what you've done. I don't think it overstates it to say that what you're doing with Tesla and Solar City may very well be what changes the world and saves the planet for us to live on it. And thank you. And
well, I should say, I very much appreciate that. But I think I should say that my role is is small. It's a huge team effort for sure. You know, at Tesla and Solar City, and there are also, of course, many other solar companies. I would not wish to take too much credit for such things, but the sentiment is appreciated.
Great. Yeah, I think you're inspiring to a lot of people, and that's really important. And I know that I absolutely love my Roadster, and I absolutely love our Model S. And I love driving around on solar-powered energy that's renewable and American-made, and it just feels wonderful to do that and to drive such fun cars. I'm excited about my Model X reservation and right. about my brokerage account balance. Thank you. And my question is, I'm sure you know that there's a lot of Tesla Motors Club groups around the country, maybe I'm sure around the world. We're here with our good friend Larry Channon, who's the founder of the Florida Tesla Motors Club. And I was wondering if you thought it would be a worthwhile thing to periodically, annually, or whatever, to get together with the heads of these chapters and talk about, you know, get feedback from them that you might not get otherwise.
That's actually that's a pretty good idea. I give that some thought. I think that might make a lot of sense. Yeah.
And maybe they can bring a friend along with them.
All right.
Hi, Jerome and Elon. Angelia Link. I'm from Williamsburg, Virginia. I want to thank you for the amazing car. I mean, I enjoy driving it every single day to work. And thanks for not making a fool out of me when I put money down on a car I'd never seen or driven. Right. it was amazing. I had to go 200 miles just to see the car I had already put a reservation on. Okay. But I love it every day. I guess my one question would be on the valet parking. Is there any thought to being able to limit the speed of the car? I mean, of course, we're all very protective of our cars. We don't want anyone else to get in it and do some crazy things. Will there be any thought to limiting that via a button on the valet?
Yes. Yes. It's technically, that actually is a function in the car already. It's just not been exposed to the end user.
Okay.
So,
do you know when it will be?
Yeah. Yeah. Right. Exactly. It goes back to the point about features that'll come out. Maybe by the end of the year, we've got a bunch of things in kind of the feature release plan that we need to get through first. There's a ton of additional functionality that we want to add to the car. Via over-the-air update, but the thing that's held that up recently is just getting the European version of the car working. So there's been a lot of work by the software team on internationalization of the software, which is obviously limited than the actual features that can be rolled out. But I can say that tell you about some of the features that are going to come in fairly soon, maybe in the next 1 to 2 months. A lot of people have been asking for the maps to have a north up capability, so you'll have that'll be rolled out in about a month or two is north up, and it'll also pre-cache the tiles. So if you sometimes we realize that is problematic. So you're going to have the that capability. There will also be the ability to tether through your phone. If you've got LTE on your phone and that's going to be faster, then you can tether through your phone and get higher speed connectivity. There will also be Wi-Fi capability. So I think that's probably some good stuff that's going to come out.
Thank you, and thank you to the whole team. You brought it's a fabulous car. Can't say enough about it. Love it. Thanks.
Hi, Elon. I'm Dave Lee from Temecula. I wanted to actually thank you first for just being so generous with all your interviews over the years. Sometime early last year, I started to watch some video interviews that you've done with reporters, and I got hooked. In over 6 months, I watched hundreds of videos, like not just from YouTube or Google. I was doing like these strange Google searches to try to find these odd video interviews with Elon Musk. And I learned just so much about entrepreneurship and first principle in business. And I really think a generation of people in the future are going to learn a lot from the things you leave behind because you've been so generous with your time. Actually, Jerome, I've watched three or four of your interviews. Even you did a presentation in Germany with Daimler before. So, yeah, anyways, my question, though, has to do with Hyperloop.
Okay.
So, you know, we've been, you know, waiting, and my wife was thinking, maybe Elon hasn't talked about it yet just because, like, someone hasn't asked him yet. Because you did mention, like, after the battery swap announcement, you know, you would talk about it. And so I noticed you haven't done many interviews after that. And so, I mean, my preference before I ask the question is, I would love to see you do the Hyperloop just because I feel like execution is going to be so important. And the scale of it is so big. I'd love to see, I don't know, your involvement. But the question is, plainly and simply, what is Hyperloop?
Well, okay. Obviously, the challenge is running SpaceX and Tesla, and of course, spending time with my kids does not leave. A lot of time left over. In fact, I'm sort of often in time triage mode, So, the Hyperloop was sort of prompted by me reading about the California high-speed rail, and sort of reading about it, and it's like, wow, it's kind of slow. You know, it's sort of the slowest bullet train in the world, and it seems it's like bullet. I mean, I don't know any bullet that goes that slow. And it's like the arrow train or something. And it's also going to be the most expensive per mile. And it wasn't really, so it's going to be like probably end up costing $100 billion. And it wasn't too long ago that California was facing bankruptcy. So this does not seem like a wise expenditure for the state. It's not as though, I'm not against public transport, but it just seems like, we ought to be trying to do something that's newer and better and exciting. And not to mention the 405, it's like, God help us if whoever was managing the 405 is managing that train. We're totally screwed. If they can't widen a lane on the 405 without creating a massive disaster, how do you make a 400 mile long train? The thought was just say what theoretically, without inventing sort of teleportation or something like that, what can you do to have the best possible journey from city center to city center, and how do you make it actually work? You know, because there's lots of things. Everything works on PowerPoint. It's like you can always make, oh, look at this pretty image. So the details matter quite a lot, I think nonetheless, even looking at the details, it's possible to create a new mode of transport that's quite effective, and well suited for, or optimally suited for, journeys between cities that are perhaps on the order of 500 miles distance. Once you get to like the 1,000 mile distance level, I think it probably makes more sense to have an airplane. I do have to write something soon, because I said I would, and it's been way too long.
Actually, if you're going to do it yourself, I totally give you permission to not let anyone know. I'd rather have you do it than, but...
It's got nothing to do with proprietary knowledge, and I have no desire to increase my net worth. This has got nothing to... It's just like, I just sort of wish there was really some really cool new transport mode being developed. I think there is a company called ET3 or ETC3 or something like that. They're sort of, I think, sort of on the right track, not quite, but I think if what they did came to fruition, I think that would be great. If anything like that, if anything sort of that was a radical improvement came to fruition, I think that would be great. So I've no sort of pride of authorship or desire to own anything in that regard at all. It's just that I would like to have something that you can really look forward to, and it seems exciting, and it can really be economically self-sustaining. I would like to be involved in such a thing, except that it would require, I would necessarily have to subtract time from Tesla, SpaceX, or family, which is really difficult. So that's the short of it.
Thank you.
All right. Okay. All right, so I apologize, I do have to head back. Jerome's going to take over from here. And
Elon, before you leave, some time ago at Southern California, at the Caltech commencement speech, you spoke about your accomplishments with Tesla, with SpaceX, and then around that same time frame, I'm not sure if it was in Hollywood or Monaco, you talked to Tony Stark and informed him about making an electric plane.
Oh, yeah.
So the vision was there to go longer distances. And then SpaceX came along, and you service this International Space Station. So even greater distances. Well, on our trip here yesterday, and I spoke with Leilani last night, we encountered a little situation over at Harris Ranch, and I'm sold with the vision of Tesla. I love it. But our situation was we were stuck in the middle of nowhere and our gas station broke down.
Okay.
So somebody up there was looking after us because we made it here.
Okay, good.
My concern is, you know, is there in your future a vision to expand the range of Tesla? And because if you are, I'll be the first one to buy that vehicle.
Okay.
But I also wanted to say before you leave that Tesla and Elon, you are changing the world.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Well, okay, great, thanks. If we've really focused on range, it would be possible to create a 500-mile range Model S today. But it would be quite expensive. So the real question is that we're trying to sort of figure out what is the right range that makes it convenient still to do long-distance travel, but isn't outrageously expensive or, you know, even more expensive than the car is today. Long term, I do think there will be longer range battery packs available, but it's the iteration interval is going to be approximately every 4 to 5 years is when we'll do sort of a step change in battery energy density and cost and range. So we're sort of aiming for, you know, maybe 3 to 3 years from now or thereabouts to have a step change improvement in the cost and range potential of the battery pack. It's quite a complicated endeavor to get there, but that's what we want to do. And on the Harris Ranch front, I should point out, if you haven't gone there recently, we've substantially expanded Harris Ranch. I think there's now 10 charging spots from there used to be one. And we haven't yet completely rolled out the, in fact, I'm not sure if we rolled it out at all, but it will be going out very soon, the increase in charge rate from 90 kilowatts to 120 kilowatts. So that should really help a fair bit.
Elon, we actually, yes, I got to give credit to my brother-in-law. I drove with him up here, and he called Tesla, and they actually instructed him to reset that station. That's why we were able to get charged to get here. But
great.
My brother-in-law, Dan, is somewhere in here in the audience, but yes, he was actually able to reset it. But thank you very much. And in the meantime, I'll be keep buying Tesla stock.
All right, thanks.
Okay, Elon?
Right. Absolutely. With that, so, thank you all very much. Deeply appreciate your support. And
thank you.
thank you for going over. So just a real quick general housekeeping. First one thing, I do want to point out, I am a technical female, and I'm an early adopter. I own a Tesla Roadster. Most of my friends are technical women, and they're also early adopters. So I'm not sure where the data set was coming from. We've gone over a little bit, and thanks to Elon for staying longer. We purposely built some extra time into the agenda. So Jerome, very big welcome.
Thank you.
So stay in line for your questions, Jerome. If you just want to take questions, if you want to talk a little bit, we're going to leave it up to you.
I'll start with a few words. Thank you very much for coming here to California. I was quite surprised when I heard the questions, how far some of you have traveled. And thank you for making those long trips. And I have seen some of the license plates in the parking lot, so many of you have come with the Model S, and I appreciate that. It's very encouraging to see cars from out of state here. So thank you for coming here. Maybe just two words about my role and what I'm trying to do. I started 3 years ago with Tesla, which makes me one of the old-timers. The company is actually nearly five times larger now than when I started, which is pretty interesting. I'm coordinating the program management for Model S. As Elon pointed out, and he didn't get too much into the details, but sorting out the last details regarding the homologation and the crash safety was a fairly intense body of work, but I'm glad we finished everything on time. And for those of you who were there, we delivered the first car just a little over a year ago in Fremont, which I think was a very nice event with some of the early adopters. And then since April 1st, and it's not a joke, Elon has asked me to lead the service organization. Thank you. And so he said, make it the best, make it that people are happy, and don't worry about cost. So I said, okay, I can do that. So it's been a very intense 3 month journey, and I assume that most of you have seen that. The service organization doubled in 3 months. That's crazy growth. Last year I was in charge of engineering, and the organization grew by 50% in 1 year, and I thought that was a lot. But now we grew by 100% in 3 months, and it's challenging. And I tell you, in April, it was not easy hiring. Now it's gotten a lot easier. You know, we've got some amazing talent applying at Tesla, coming from some extremely reputable service centers, and people want to join us, and they want to rally around the mission and bring their expertise, technical expertise, as well as expertise dealing with customers and making sure that they're always taken care of. So that's the mission, right? I want to make sure that you are always super satisfied with the service you receive. Yeah? And we put in place, I think, some amazing regional general managers that should take care of that. But if it doesn't happen, you know, just contact me, and I will follow up. There's no problem. I'm easy to find. You know, I'm the only Jerome. So just reach out. Some of the things we put in place. We have a fleet of about 300 loaner cars now throughout North America. And I know Elon said, let's put loaners, and everybody had the expectation that the day after we could have 300 cars, but I just can't do it. We can't make, you know, so many cars at once for this purpose, because all the cars are already reserved by customers, and we don't want to make the customers wait. So I mean, it was a bit difficult, and thank you for your patience. So that's one thing. We have valet service in pretty much every major metro region. So not maybe in the small areas, but all the ones we have valet service. So if you don't want to come to the service center, you don't have to. The valet will come, pick up your car, bring it back, all that stuff. All the major service centers are also open 7 days a week. Thank you. Seattle, here, of course, Los Angeles, Houston, Dania Beach, Queens. I don't know. I mean, if there is another one that is not open 7 days a week and that you think should be, let me know, and then we'll do that. And we're also going to increase the hours as much as needed. And by as much as needed, I really mean it, you know. So if it needs to be 24 hours a day, then we'll do that, you know. Yeah, that's some of the measures we've put in place, and so that you are aware of the attention that we're paying to this every day of the week at 5 p.m. Me and some engineers and all the regional managers, we are reviewing all the interesting service cases. So the gentleman that was there stuck at Harris Ranch, this is probably something we're going to discuss tonight at 5 and discuss why is it that it happened that the thing had to be reset. You know, because any incident that prevents you from going, we consider to be of critical importance, and I want to review every day to make sure that not only we address it, but that we address the root cause. So that's a little bit. Yeah, basically that's what we're trying to do. And if there is anything that you can think that we could do better in terms of service, let me know. We want you to be happy 100% of the time, and that's what we're striving for. In particular, if you think that there are locations where we should be opening a service centers because it's not properly served, you know, and it's too far, it's not convenient, and there would be a large group of Tesla vehicles, Roadster and Model S, that would be open, please let me know, okay? Sometimes I feel a little, I feel like flying blind, and I'd like to get maybe, you know, I got recommendations from the people on the team, but I'd like to hear from you guys as well, locations where you think would be a good area to open a service center. And that's it. Maybe we can ask some questions. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Andy. I wanted to say the Model S is one of the best products of any kind that I've ever bought. So thanks to everyone at Tesla for that. And it was really great to hear sort of your commitment to making like the services, you know, best that it could be as well. Have you guys found that since all of the more exposure models S has had in spring of this year, the good reviews and all that stuff, has that made any difference in how you guys are able to deal with third parties, suppliers, you know, finance companies, you know, that sort of thing? Because we did hear in the past that sometimes you had trouble with suppliers not taking you seriously or not, you know, giving your work, you know, as much priority as it should have.
Yeah, so I have to be also careful about what I say. You know, I'm also bound by some of the rules of being a public company. But just going back to the example I gave, you know, that I'm happy to share, in able to attracting talent at Tesla in terms of service, it's a lot easier. Seeing more cars on the road, seeing the company being more successful, and on the I think has helped us a lot in terms of attracting talent on the service organization. Definitely. So I think you can assume, you know, that the similar halo effect is the same for the other parties that we're dealing with. Yeah. So things are a little bit easier. Yeah.
Cool. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hi, Jerome. How you doing? My name's Dave. I own Signature 1094. I think it's the last one of the lower 48. And my wife owns 1181. And I know one of your largest challenges right now are ramping up and trying to cope with how fast the company is expanding and going. So two things in mind on the delivery and also with service. I'm wondering if you guys can't leverage the technology in the car to facilitate lowering your headcount and making things a little bit more efficient. And the way I'm proposing this for you is in the delivery, that the car should have a tutorial built within it. In other words, the Model S should be able to tell me how to use it right on the screen as one. Mm-hmm. And I'm talking interactive, it points, it presses mm-hmm. buttons, it makes lights light, it shows me all the warnings, et cetera, et cetera. And then from a service standpoint, I would like my car to tell me that you've got 3,500 miles on it, maybe you need to look at the tires. Your service is coming up, and then another screen pop and go, here are the available slots at your local service center. Can you get it right on the car, right on the screen? It makes it seamless. It cuts out some people for you, especially if it's integrated properly and executed properly. I'd like to help you do that.
Yeah, thank you. I think that's a very good yes. It's a very good idea. We're always catching up a little bit to what we want to go. I mean, definitely having the owner's manual on the center display for me is a priority. Okay. Unfortunately, there is a lot of other priorities at Tesla, so sometimes we have to wait. But the idea that we have a paper owner's manual is revolting to me.
Yes.
So
yes.
And from day one, I said, it needs to go. Why do we have to cut a tree, or even if it's recycled paper, to put an owner's manual when we have this beautiful display there? So I am pushing for this very much. All in right. terms of tutorials, I appreciate that. However, you know that we cannot have video on the display.
So that's... Even- So, web application, something like that.
Yeah, so we have some, I think, neat videos that some of our colleagues put together, but we cannot display video on the screen. I hope everybody understands that this is the right thing to do.
Sure, and you can go and pass video. I'm talking about it actually interacts. You know,
absolutely. In terms of service, I think. So we are trying to maintain your car remotely. You know that. Everybody
yes.
knows that, right? So some of you, and I apologize for that, have had to come to get their 12-volt battery replaced. Now, we replaced the supplier. No, make no mistake about this. I couldn't
Good.
Wait. But unfortunately, we have quite a few cars. It's not all cars, but in some cars, the 12-volt battery will have to be replaced. Well, we don't want anybody to be stranded, so we are sending a message and we're inviting you to come in service when that 12-volt battery needs to be replaced. So I think what we need to do is, you're absolutely right, instead of us getting an alert calling you, we could directly give you the alert and then self-schedule. I completely endorse that.
All right.
And we'll move towards that direction. Absolutely. Very good.
That?
Very
Just
good idea.
One other quick favor for me. Could you run this from Freddie? He forgot to sign my signature before it left the factory.
I can sign it, or I can bring it to Elon to sign. So.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that.
Hey, so 5 more minutes.
It's okay. You know, I don't want
okay?
to feel... I'm going back to work. I need to be there at 5, but as you realize... And let me check what time it is. No, it's fine. There's plenty of time.
It's 4 o'clock. So
yeah.
Is everyone here...
It's 15 minutes away, so...
Okay. So yeah. Is everyone here okay with sessions being cut a little short? Yes?
Yeah.
Yes? Okay, I'm going to make that call because we would rather be talking to you
okay.
right now, Jerome.
Good.
So,
no
okay.
problem.
Thank you.
Oh, you're welcome.
There you go. Hi, Jerome. I'm Dinesh from Pleasanton, California. I'm just curious, being a green car company, I'm sure you think of all other aspects of service and taking care of the car and how you can make those green. Have you given any thought to how you're washing the cars and wasting water to do that? And there's better alternatives out there. Have you considered that at all?
Yeah. So, all right. So my personal example, I park right away, far away, because I don't want you to see my car, because it's all this stuff that you shouldn't see. So it's okay, you can't really see from outside. So, but the so I don't wash it ever, you know. So because I think, you know, I agree with you that the water is I feel personally, that's a personal opinion, is a little bit of a waste. But we are experimenting with the alternative companies. I think there is a company that is just outside behind the building here that we're working with in some locations.
That's actually us. So
oh, okay. So yeah. So. No self-promotion, but
no.
we're experimenting, you know, with everything, you know. As I said, in general, I wouldn't be a great customer personally because I never wash, you know. I try to keep it clean, but anyway.
Thank you.
Hi, Jerome. I'm Dave from Toronto, Canada, roadster owner. Question on the loaner program. It seems that the service centers are having a hard time holding on to their loaners. They're getting sold just as fast as they're being delivered.
Mm-hmm.
Any thoughts on tweaking the policy to make it tougher to buy the loaners to lock in that inventory?
Yeah, well, that's a good question. And you know what? I'm under extreme pressure from the service organization to hold the loaners for a set period of time, you know. Unfortunately, we still have very razor-thin margins. If we want to prosper, we need to be profitable. And therefore, if that car is sold, you know, we will try to give it to the person who bought it as soon as possible. I think the real effort that I want to follow is that loaners shouldn't be used for more than 1 or 2 days. So the service repair shouldn't take that long, you know, and therefore, you know, it should not be a problem because they would be just cycled naturally. You come back, you get your car, or we bring your car back, and then we can get that loaner to whoever bought it. And then I'm making, and this is something that I couldn't do in the second quarter because we were just, you know, in the middle of a lot of things, but every week in the third quarter, there is a certain number of cars we're building that are replacement loaners. So it was a little random and chaotic, I have to say, in the second quarter, but in the third quarter, I'm tired of hearing the stories too, you know, I have to deal with them. So I just like, okay, every week we'll be building a certain amount of cars so we can replace the one that we're selling. Yeah, I had to discuss with a certain person, but he agreed and we're good to go.
Okay, thanks. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Leanne Herman. I'm from Tallahassee, Florida. I'm here with my husband, who was sweet enough to buy me a Model S.
That's a nice gift.
That was my 50th birthday present. So we signed up for it in 2009, and people told me, you know, you've been awfully patient waiting for that car. And I'm like, it didn't even occur to me I was being patient. You know, I was just excited. So when I went down to test drive it in November last year, first time I'd seen one in person, because there's nothing near Tallahassee, went down to Dania Beach and test drove it. I told him, I said, you know, because we don't have a lot of money, I said, if it doesn't blow me away, I'm not going to do it. Mm-hmm. You know, I've had the reservation for 4 years, but if it doesn't blow me away, I'm going to walk away from it. And of course, it blew me away. If you can just tell people, all you got to do is drive this car. That's all you got to do to sell it. You just get somebody behind the wheel, because if you've driven the Model S, you will never want to drive anything else. Now, I have to say, I've never driven a Roadster. I'd love to drive one. Never driven a Roadster. But the Model S is amazing. I turned around. I had a Honda 1990 for 23 years. Stick shift, four-cylinder motor. And I went from that to this Model S, and it's just unreal. You know, I'm just so ecstatic. And I'm a real green person, so this is like my paradise car, because it wraps everything into one. And I wanted to hug Elon so hard when he was here. But I just want to tell you how much I appreciate it. I'd had one little issue on design of the S, and it may not be the S, it may be something you might think about for the X. Mm-hmm. I don't know. Other cars have had this feature. I've never driven those either, but it's for people that are vertically challenged like me with short legs. The idea of having the pedals come forward, because when you move your little seat all the way up, it tends to change your visual. I haven't had a problem with my S, but I don't know what the X will be like. So I just wondered if y'all had even thought about that possibly for shorter folks with shorter legs.
It's a good thought. You know, I'll let me think. You know, the adjustable pedal you see in some vehicles, typically you can also address by moving the seats and making sure it's on the right track. And the steering column is also adjustable. But let me follow up. I for S, you know, and it'll be difficult to change. But let me look at what it is for X.
I haven't seen the issue as being a problem for me for my line of vision. Mm-hmm. But that's the biggest issue I've had with other cars I've test driven, is once I scoot my seat up and I try to see where I'm going. Usually the post here, and then the post here is completely and gives me huge blind spots. So we're talking about being safety being number one. What
that's
Elon
right.
said. I just wondered if you guys had thought about that too. So
thank you
so much.
You're welcome.
Hi, Jerome. Alan Soule from Sebastopol. I like to take road trips, and the superchargers are just fabulous, and where they're rolling out is great. But there are going to also be other fast chargers available that are mostly going to be the CHAdeMO. Mm-hmm. I would suggest that somebody come up with an adapter. I know that it's a little bit complicated with communications and stuff, but if possible, come up with an adapter that you go CHAdeMO into the test.
Yeah, thank you. There is so CHAdeMO is. I have to be careful what I say because I cannot make forward-looking statements. CHAdeMO is important in some of the countries where we intend to expand, right. And Elon already talked about it, so I can say that. Therefore, I think it's a very reasonable request you just made.
Oh, hi, Jerome. Hi. My name is Charlie Culp. I'm from College Station, Texas. There are now four Model S's in College Station.
And thank you for supporting us in Texas.
You bet.
Appreciate it.
We're not the most backward state, but we're second.
No. I love Texas. You know.
I do, too. It's great. And I just really wanted to compliment you in all the service that exists on that. So you're inheriting an organization that does great service. Now, I also prepared I'm a professor and also a designer. And I have a few little things here, if you'll accept this piece of paper.
Absolutely.
That has some software and some recommended hardware changes.
Excellent.
Thank you much.
I love suggestions. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Hi, Jerome. My name's Kip Leong. I live here in the Bay Area. The other day, I took my kids over to Fairfield to visit the Jelly Belly factory. I hope that that's something that Elon could do with his kids if he ever.
Maybe they're there right now.
But the Jelly Belly factory is not quite as cool as the Tesla factory. But one thing that did happen on the way there is I punched in I asked for it in the navigation, and then the navigation route took me over there, and it told me to take a hard right off the freeway, through the trees, into the parking lot of the Jelly Belly factory. So there's some problems with the navigation system, and I.
I thought this was only operating on Apple. Yeah.
And I also want to let you know that the traffic thing doesn't update properly, and it drives me crazy. Like if I zoom out, it seems to be right, but if I zoom back in, it doesn't update, and it's still cached from the old data. And that thing, I think, really needs to be addressed. And I would love for the navigation and the web browser to be integrated. Like, say I go to Yelp, and I see a restaurant, I want to hit the address in Yelp and have it navigate there. And finally, laundry list. I would like to be able to kind of like hold my finger down on a spot on the map and have it navigate to that spot.
Yeah, thank you. Those are good suggestions. As Elon said earlier, you know, we have a roadmap of improvements. Honestly, the number one request that we got regarding navigation was. The ability to change the orientation from up north to the driving direction. So this is coming very soon. I already have it. So it works. It's great, actually. I think most of you will like it. It's especially amazing when you are in satellite mode, you know. So it's. I think that most of you will enjoy it. So I agree with you on some of the features that you have highlighted. They're all very reasonable. I know some of you have been extremely patient between the time when you have reserved the vehicle and the time we've been able to deliver it, and we appreciate your trust during all that time. And I can only ask for a little bit more patience until we get the ability to implement those features. But the awesome thing, really, that with a Tesla that you can't have with anybody else is it's not going to cost you a penny to get all those features. One morning you will wake up and they will be in the car. Yeah. And I think that's
that was awesome. That Thank you. Yeah. Okay.
Hi, I'm Bill from Los Angeles. I have an early signature. Two feature requests. When you pick up a loaner, it would be great if you could insert a USB stick into your car, download your user settings, and upload them into the loaner. It also would really be important when your car is being serviced, in case they accidentally wipe out the user settings, which happened to me once, and then I had to reassemble my gate in order to program the home link again. So backing up to the cloud or to USB of the user settings would be really helpful. The second thought I had was, most people are going to navigate to the superchargers through your navigation system. Mm-hmm. And so you ought to be able to know roughly when people are going to arrive. And you also, with maybe a webcam, could know how many people are there. And for planning long trips, you could actually put together either a rudimentary reservation system, or if not that, at least warn people if 50 people are heading towards the Harris Supercharger, and they're going to arrive all around the same time, it wouldn't be that hard for you to know that. And that would be useful information to feed back to people.
Well, let me think about it, you know. Presumably, if you're going to LA and you're already on I-5, you know, you're not going to have much choice. You know, you are going to have to charge at Harris Ranch, you know. I think that the other way to look at it is that we need to make sure that we have enough stations at each of the stations, at each of the locations. So be aware, I don't know if this is clear to everybody, but that there is an entire team that works on superchargers. And that we monitor utilization very clearly. So we can see which of the locations are fully utilized at any point in time, and therefore that's a sign that we need to add more stations. So Harris Ranch was clearly not properly thought through. But we change quickly, right? That's the beauty of Tesla, is we have a very short feedback loop. So we added a lot of stations. Another one personally I had said this is going to be a problem is Gilroy, because a lot of people are going there for shopping, and everybody has a little bit of different view on what etiquette is and may decide to park there. We're not going to police that, you know, let's be honest. You know, everybody needs to kind of act in a responsible manner. I think we're adding 10 more stations in Gilroy, so we'll go from 4 to 14. And I think that's next week or the week after or something like this. I think they're building them, so that's going to go pretty quick. So I think the right way to look at it is to make sure that we have enough stations at each of the proper location. And we have an entire team that monitors the utilization. Yeah.
Okay, we're going to take just one more short question. The powers that be above me.
Okay.
So we've got a hard stop coming here. So which side's next?
This side.
Short, Chris.
Hi, Jerome. My name is Brent. I'm local here. Hopefully this is an easy question. Vehicle to grid, vehicle to home. I know those are big future endeavors potentially for EVs in general. But the Model S, and I assume maybe the Model X, all they've really featured out is the 12-volt outlet. Is there any contemplation either offer an option or accessory that would allow you to plug in maybe just one or two home outlets to use for home backup power in an emergency or on camping or tailgating or?
You know what? I have never discussed this with JB, I don't know. I don't know is the unfortunately the answer I have to give. You know, but yeah, I don't know. I'll have to think in terms of efficiency whether this is the right thing to do. I don't see any efficiency problem because, as you know, the Model S is extremely efficient at converting power coming out of the wall to put in the car. There's not a whole lot of loss there. But if it goes out, would there be any loss as well? So I don't know. I'm sorry. Send me an email and I'll get the answer for you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Well, thank you, everybody, for your time, and enjoy the rest.
If you could all stay just 1 minute, I've got a couple of housekeeping things. Thank you. So I'm going to take the factory thing over and leave it with Colette tonight, so a few more people can sign.
Exactly, okay? Yeah, otherwise I'll take it.
Okay, thank you. Thanks. Okay, if everyone could just take a minute, some quick housekeeping. One, we will still have the big thank you note over at the factory party for people to sign. So you'll be able to sign it there, and we will get it over to them then. Reminder, the factory party, closed toe shoes are requested. Ride chairs will... What? It is okay for the party. We were told... Okay, so I've been corrected by Tesla. Those of you who do not...